In this video, I'm reviewing a brand here that I've not covered before, MINIX, and this here is the NGC-5. It's a Windows 10 mini PC, powered by the Core i5-8279U. Now the 8279U does have 4 cores, 8 threads, maximum turbo is 4.1 GHz, and it is powered with also Iris Plus 655 graphics. A 28 watt part. Performance, even though it's 8th gen, is very similar to the 11th gen, the 1165G7, only slightly slower. It does come with 8 GB of RAM, 256 GB of storage, dual LAN ports on it, Wi-Fi AC, SD card reader, and you can even install, if you wanted to, a nano SIM and a modem in this model here. So I'll show you the internals, the thermals, the performance, and exactly what you can expect here out of the NGC-5. So in the box, you'll find our power supply, which is rated to 90 watts. We have a user manual, which is in various different languages, 2 external antennas, HDMI cable. They include a VESA bracket for mounting it on the back of a TV or a monitor. And we do get this, some extra little screws in here. There is an adapter for optical audio out. So the mini PC has a nice, small, compact size. It's not very high. You can see we have a Kensington lock slot. This is the exit vent for the fan, so all the hot air will be pushed out from this side. Reset button, and that is the 2 connectors there for the external antennas for our wireless. On the back of it here, we've got a lot of ports. So it does support 3 displays out at 4K 60. So DisplayPort, HDMI, and then Type-C video out. We've got 2 USB 3.1 ports right here, 2 gigabit LANs. This is our power in, intake vent right here. And then on this side, we do have optical audio out, okay? And also 3.5 millimeter with microphone support. This is our micro SD card, another 2 USB 3s, and we have a COM port right here, which you don't normally see. The top of the Neo NGC-5, you'll find the MINIX branding, and then the underside of it right here, just got a few stickers, serial numbers and whatnot, and there is this little hatch here, so that's an easy access hatch, just 2 screws to remove, and you can gain access to the NVMe drive in here, which is 256 GB. If that was not enough, you could then swap that out and put up to 2 TB in there. You can see that's the little plastic hatch that just goes over the top. What I'll do now is I'll open it up and I'll show you how we can add more RAM, because this only comes with 8 GB. You would probably want to add another 8 so we can have dual channel for best performance and 16 GB in total. We have 4 rubber feet on the underside here. You just need to peel them off and they're using adhesive there. There's no damage to them at all. And then simply 4 screws and then the bottom will lift right off. And we can see now the cooling fan right there, and it does have a thermal copper transfer pipe in there. And then in order to access our RAM, you do need to flip around the motherboard. The good thing is that there is a SIM slot right here. So it will take a nano SIM, and you can then slot in a modem. So if you did need that extra, you're able to do that. We don't often see this option in mini PCs. So 2 SODIMM slots here. I will be adding another 8 GB of RAM to give us the 16 in total, just so it's in dual channel, so we can see what the maximum performance that is possible out of this particular mini PC. We do have our wireless card right here, which is also upgradable. You could change this and swap it out if you needed to. First up, our BIOS. So we do have a few advanced settings in here, okay, that you can change and tweak, but really not a lot, okay? So it's quite a lockdown BIOS here. CPU configuration, you can just disable or enable the turbo. Of course, that's on by default. And power settings, not a lot in here. So you cannot actually change the power limits for this chip. You'd have to use Intel's Extreme Tuning Utility for that if you wanted to tweak it. Now, this is an interesting one, which is the Restore AC Power Loss. So you can turn that on. If you're going to be running this as a server or on a switch or a router, that's very handy to have. So when it loses power, it can automatically power itself back on as soon as it detects that power there. So let's jump into Windows now. Okay, so this mini PC does come with Windows 10 Pro. It is slightly dated, the version there, but that's normal. You have to run Windows Update. So So I did install that extra 8 gigabytes of RAM, so I've got 16 in total. We do lose out on a little bit because it's dedicating some of that to that Iris Plus graphics there. Now, general performance, I won't go over documents, spreadsheets, and things like that. It's very, very good. This is a capable, even though it's an older chipset now, capable quad core with the 8 threads. So maximum turbo is up to 4.1 gigahertz. It's a 28 watt part, so it's Coffee Lake U, and there's the Iris Plus 655. So that is why it is a little bit more potent. So it's not as good as what we now have, of course, with the Iris Xe graphics, which is the latest one. But for a couple of generations ago, this was not bad at all. It was quite a good one. So we do have with this 48 executional cores, and the performance Geekbench 5 here, almost 1,100 points there for single core score, and over 4,000. Seems pretty standard there for the type of chip. This one is okay with the 8279U. And just another thing to point out too, that we've got those 2 gigabit LAN ports on board, but the wireless card, which thankfully is upgradable. Now, I would swap this out with an Intel AX200 or 201. This one here is the dual band wireless AC3168. It's not that quick, and you can get around 300 megabits per second transfers with it. But the newer cards, the AX200 and 201, for example, I'm able to achieve about 1.3 gigabits per second. So those are very, very quick. Wireless range and reception, I must comment on, is very, very good. Very strong because of those external antennas. They're just so much better than the internal ones, and they've got a lot more gain to them. So that definitely is a benefit there we're gaining from this mini PC. And here's our internal storage. So the NVMe drive is, well, it's not the fastest, but it's certainly better than SATA 3, which would be capping at about 550 megabytes reads and writes for sequentials, that is. And there you can see much better. So it is quite quick. It does not hold up the system at all. And overall system performance is excellent with this. So just going into very quickly to show you that with the file manager here, that Windows does have about 200 gigabytes free on first boot. And you can, of course, easily upgrade this drive. One thing the Iris 655 Plus graphics is good at is video playbacks. This is a very demanding file, which I do test out in all of my videos with mini PCs, and that's 140 megabits per second, 4K, 10-bit ATVC. And you can see a few little stutters in the beginning, and once going, it is smooth and doesn't then drop any frames. Now, I will test out another clip here, which is a HDR one here from Sony, and that's just fine. That runs, again, without dropping any frames there. So VP9 codec support, AGVC, is going to be able to run it just fine natively with the Iris 655 Plus. And spreadsheet performance, I do have a very, very large one open here. Sorry, this is a document. And it's fine, okay? So the really large ones, and including spreadsheets, not a problem there. Editing them, you can do all of that. And it doesn't lag out without any problems. And our Cinebench score, so we get just over 3,700 points. Now that score is actually very good because the 11th gen 1165G7 will just get slightly over this. So really there's not much of a difference going from the 14 nanometers now to the 10 nanometers on the 11th gen. This 8th gen is very, very similar in terms of performance right here with Cinebench, and then the single core score of just over 1,000 points. And then our thermals, when you do push it really hard, something like exporting video or gaming or Cinebench, it does peak at 88 degrees Celsius. Now my ambient room temperatures are approximately 24 degrees Celsius, so it does get a little warm. It does trigger then thermal throttling, but only when you do something really demanding. Now the fan noise, you do hear it ramp up. It does get a little loud there. It's not the quietest mini PC I have tested out, but when you're just doing something that's light tasks and things, it doesn't make a lot of noise, and the fan seems to almost pretty much turn off, and it's just occasionally on and cycling there. Power use, you can see, well, it gets up to 30 watts there just with stress testing it right now with benchmarks, and it will at the wall end up using about 47 watts is what I've seen it peak at so far. And onto 4K video editing. So these clips here are 4K 100 megabit per second ones from my Sony A6300 back then when I recorded this clip. Now the timeline here runs fine with a quarter playback resolution. It does not drop any frames. It doesn't seem laggy, but on full here, I've noticed it seemed to be at times a little choppy, but it's not actually too bad. But do remember, I'm running this in dual channel. Now, if you were running this with the stock configuration as you get it out of the box with only 8 gigabytes of RAM, and in single channel, the performance would not be as good as this. But you can see dragging along the timeline here, that's very fast and does perform well, better than other mini PCs I've looked at that don't have the Iris 655 Plus graphics. But how does it export? Will it be as fast as others? Let's find out now. I'll export the 4K YouTube preset here, 1 minute of footage, and we'll see how long it takes. So there we go, 1 minute. Bring up my little timer here. So start on the timer, export. And it should get through this quite quickly. And as you can see, it is powering ahead. So it should be just over a minute. All right, here we go, about to finish up. So we are looking at approximately, you could say, 1 minute and 9 seconds for 1 minute of the 4K YouTube preset. They're exporting it. And can it game? Well, this is GTA 5, and I have it set on normal settings, not the lowest, 1080p, and we're getting around 40 sometimes frames per second, mid, as you can see right now, mid 30s. So it is okay for older titles. You can just play these games. So this is a step up from the typical UHD graphics that would normally have, this being the Iris 655 Plus. Certainly does perform a little bit better. So if I just get out of the car here, frame rate should increase. You can see it's now around the 40s when you're outside, so that's good. And overall, it will be playable, just not an amazing frame rate. But let's have a look at an even lighter title, and that is Counter-Strike that I often test out. So we get a relatively good frame rate here for integrated graphics, around 100 frames per second. It does dip down to sometimes 40 when there's a lot going on. We've got smoke on screen, a lot of different characters there. So this is just a bot, so a very easy kill for me there. Now, if this was the Iris Xe graphics, new architecture, then of course we would be looking at probably about 120 frames per second, a lot better frame rate. Still for Iris 655 Plus, this isn't bad, and it's over 60 frames per second. I am running low settings, however, and 1080p is the resolution. And when it comes to the Windows 11 requirements, this mini PC does support it. So you can happily install that if you wanted to do so. I'm still waiting for it to mature a little bit more. So we do have the TPM 2.0 that it needs, secure boot. And of course, the spec of this mini PC is enough to run Windows 11. And then our Linux support. So it will run Linux, this unit here, without a problem. And it does have, of course, the dated wireless chip in it. So drivers is not going to be an issue. The 8th gen as well, no problems with that. So we'll also run Windows 11. It meets all of the requirements from Windows 11 to be able to upgrade to it and install it. So that is good. It's got the secure boot on there. So everything's fine with that. So what do I like about this mini PC? Performance-wise, with the second slot of RAM installed, so it's in dual channel as I tested it out, it will perform very similar to an 11th gen, which is the 1165 G7 chip. So that's great. Very close to that kind of performance there with the Cinebench scores that I was getting there and I showed you. However, it just comes with that 8 gigabytes of RAM. I really believe this should ship with two sticks of 8 gigabytes, giving us 16 gigabytes in total, but most importantly, dual channel RAM configuration so we can get that maximum performance that I showed you in this video. So you can run three displays at 4K 60, that's another positive. We can upgrade the SSD, you can swap out that Wi-Fi card. So if you're not happy with the Wi-Fi AC, which I'm not, I would change it for Wi-Fi AX200 or AX201 from Intel, which does have Bluetooth 5 support with it and much better speeds and much better throughput. So we've got two gigabit LAN ports on there, which is great. We even have a nano SIM slot on the motherboard and room there to install a modem. If you wanted to set up and run that, this is one of very few mini PCs that I've seen that do have that. It ships with Windows 10 Pro, a valid license. Fan noise is okay, but when you push it hard, you certainly do hear it like most mini PCs around. It does use up to about 45 watts there. It can peak up at total and gets up to about 88 degrees as I have shown you. It will peak at that once the fans kick in at the full RPM. It does lower down a little bit. So there we go. That is the NGC-5 from MINIX. Thank you so much for watching this review.